Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for giving up your time this afternoon, especially if you've already had a busy day in school, as no doubt many of you already have, or nursery setting, wherever you've come from. So it's much appreciated that you've come along to this session this afternoon. My name is Paula Owens, and I'm a teacher by profession. I've taught in foundation stage, key stage one, and key stage two. I've been a deputy head, and I was the GA curriculum lead for a number of years for primary. I've also written some resources for Digimap schools and some resources for the Ordnance Survey. And in fact, the one on the screen here is hopefully going to be launched, if not today, sometime this week. This is going to be a free guide to teaching map skills to inspire a sense of place and adventure in the early years from the Ordnance Survey. And it will be freely available on the website imminently. I haven't seen it's there yet, but Darren assures me it will be there very soon. So what I'm going to do today, I'm going to draw on some ideas from this free document to illustrate to you with some ideas for mapping in the early years and talk a little bit about that, and also about some resources from Digimaps and how Digimaps can support mapping. So this is about using and making maps in the early years, and I'm sure many of you will be from different stages across the Early Years Foundation curriculum, which does have quite a varied range in terms of developmental ages as well. So the aims today are to feel more confident about using and making maps across the areas of learning in the early years, to have a better understanding of how maps can support pupils in that area within the Early Years Framework called Understanding the World, but also how maps link to other areas of learning, because of course in the early years foundation stage all these areas are very much linked, and also to feel more confident as a subject leader in identifying the early threads of geography with progression in mind, and we'll see why that matters a little bit later on. So what do babies dream about? Food, warmth, comfort. The DFE comment that babies use their spatial reasoning skills to recognize body parts and the location of objects and people around them, and that young children go on to learn and understand these concepts through play. And in fact, Twan commented many years ago that babies are kind of innate mappers in the sense that they learn to orientate themselves towards their mothers and towards their fathers and towards areas of comfort and towards their food. And Goswami tells us that we now know that even very young children can think logically using symbolic and abstract material. Even babies are capable of these basic forms of learning and reasoning. And as the child's knowledge base grows with their working memory, then these maps and mapping activities can support and develop this knowledge base across all the areas of learning, but particularly in that one in which geography sits, understanding the world. And it's interesting that that quote from the DFE comes from the spatial reasoning pages on the maths. And of course, these are so interlinked, so I'll be stressing that all the way through. So let's move on from babies to very young children, and about something that's absolutely crucial to making and enjoying maps. And that is the fact that children are innate explorers. They are curious, deeply wanting to understand their surroundings. This is from an article that was appeared in Primary Geography, in which I just followed a couple of small children and taped everything that they were saying and later annotated it to pictures of their activities. And we can see how, as you all well know, that very small children are not interested in the big landscape pictures. They're interested in the small detail of everyday life, and they're using that developing vocabulary to really interrogate what's going on around them. And we can feel the excitement in this scene, I hope you can anyway, of look, I found a crab, I found a worm, and then wondering what's in that mysterious block of water there. So we want to really nurture that curiosity. So coming back to why do maps matter then, and that's going to be my starting point. What's so special about maps in the early years? And I've got this wonderful quote from a very inspirational head teacher, Helen Martin. And I'm going to let you read that quote. I'm going to pull out some bits from it in a minute. but I think it really summarizes for us just the importance of maps in these early years settings. We are guiding young children's curiosity. We know they love to explore, and we're providing play-based experiences that are messy and exploratory, but very vital to all aspects of their development. Maps are collaborative, they're a creative enterprise, and we engage them with the land and the landscape around them. And in doing this, we help children to give meaning to places and get a sense of who they are in the world. So the most important message, I think, for us as educators is that we start from where the children are, from this deep, innate sense of exploration, play, and curiosity. And if we can spark that curiosity in the world around them, then that's absolutely vital. And by doing that, we can then go on to start talking about it, embodying it in kind of the activities that we provide, and develop map making and modelling throughout. Now, this is an extract from the document, and it just reminds us how much these different areas of learning interweave with each other. And I've called this the curriculum weft and weave. And we've got these four strands of literacy, maths, understanding the world, and art and designing. And they're all intertwining with communication and language, physical, and the physical and personal, social, and emotional areas of learning. And in the document, I say that maps and mapping are a really vibrant part of this. And I've given some examples in each of these different areas to try and highlight for us just what maps can do. So if we think about, for example, just maths and the communication and language interface, then maps can really help to bring alive children's ability to organize spatial information and to talk about it and communicate it. If we look at the interface between personal, social, and emotional, for example, in maths, then we can develop children's confidence using maps to be able to evaluate and estimate distance and direction. And of course, in that very strong strand of understanding the world, then we can enable children to talk about people and places and to actively explore the world. And as far as their personal development goes, we can talk about diversity and culture and identity. So I won't read all of those off, but this is just an extract from that document. We've also got these three key aspects of the early years foundation stage framework. We've got the playing and exploring strand, creating and thinking critically strand, and the active learning strand. And maps help us in all these different areas to move forward, to develop these areas of learning, to move towards and beyond, hopefully, the early learning goals. So in playing and exploring, maps can really help children to investigate and experience things. The active learning, maps help children concentrate and keep on trying if they encounter difficulties. They are an aid to exploration and self-regulation. And maps also help children to develop and share their own ideas and make links between these ideas and how they can develop strategies for doing things. So again, there's very powerful interconnections at play. Now, something else that features in this free guide from the Ordnance Survey is a progression grid that talks about the kinds of things we might expect children to be able to do in different areas of map making from birth to three, from three to four, and from four to five. And this dovetails with a document on the Digimap School's website called a progression in mapping document that is free to download whether you belong already or not. But before this document was created, it only went down to age five. So this takes it right back to birth. And these are kind of generalities. And I've tried to use some examples to kind of explain what this might mean in practice. So for example, if we think about from birth to three, and this is a really big developmental jump, if you like, from birth to three, such a lot happens. So it doesn't do justice to what children are capable of doing, but it just gives kind of an idea. For example, in children beginning to use and interpret maps, we know that babies are beginning to use all their senses in this hands-on exploration of natural materials, other objects, and then as they grow bigger, they're beginning to use pictorial maps for play. If we think about drawing, this is the age when children begin to use mark making and gestures to explain their meaning. And if we think about the use of digital maps, even children this young begin to have an understanding that the sat nav in mummy and daddy's car or whoever's car can help you find your way around. And they might even begin to play online video games and manipulate shapes in space. So there is a lot going on in this age range. And by the way, these progression documents have been very much informed by the wonderful work from Simon Catling. So do look him up, and he's written some excellent stuff on map development that's well worth reading. So what does this think and look like in practice? So here we've got babies using their senses to explore surroundings. We've got children able to use simple patterns. Top tip, by the way, chocolate boxes, anything like that, really good for organising found objects and thinking about patterns and colours. And also thinking about where things have been located. You can relate a grid on the ground to a grid in a chocolate box and collect and organise materials. And children are beginning to point to directions as well. So having lots of signs out of doors, directions and signs and outdoor labels as well, and encouraging children to lead on routes and be guided on routes and walks around the school grounds and beyond the school gates as well and around the nursery. If we look at the progression from 3 to 4, thinking about nursery, we can see that children are developing a little bit further now. And there's very much a kind of a crossover between the previous one, because age 3 is a very magical age in which all kinds of crossovers and exciting things happen and children become much more able and aware. So children begin to understand that maps hold information. They begin to make imaginary maps with marks that have meaning now. And they're able to use journey strings, for example, to recall and sequence journeys. If you haven't ever come across journey strings, it's where you have a string, length of string, and supporting a child, you can have a walk and collect things along the walk, tie them onto the journey string, and then when you come back, you've got a lovely sequence memory that you can get the children to talk about and draw a linear map from. Children are beginning to describe familiar routes. They're beginning to use more appropriate vocabulary and directional language. As far as perspective and scale goes, they're beginning to talk about distance and they have an idea now that some places are further away than others. So they're beginning to explore scale through small world play as well. As I say, all this will be in the free document, all these grids. So what does this look like in action? This is another article from Primary Geography. And here we've got a 3.5-year-old who has been hiding her teddy and explaining why she's put it where she has. And she said, I've put it here so it can hide from the monsters. And apparently the teddy is saying, or the figure is saying, you can't see me, I'm invincible and you cannot destroy me. So from this, we can see that this child is able to use this directional language. It's near a car park. She's able to give explanations as to why this spatial location matter. And she can also think about how her toy is feeling. She's happy to be hiding. So she's beginning to use appropriate vocabulary and directional language. It's fitting the model that we've just talked about. But it's also showing that intrinsic mix, if you like, of emotional thought and cognitive thought working together, which is really important to develop. And we can develop this further because we can add these pictures. And we can take children around on a walk. They can hide their toy figures. And then we can add them to Digimaps. We can use aerial imagery to talk about whereabouts in the school grounds they are. And if we model this and do it regularly, children are very adept at recognizing particular landmarks. And we can then use the toggle tool to, once the picture's been added, to later on, when children are more confident, to toggle across and turn that aerial view into a map view. So we're moving from curiosity to exploration through play. We're developing spatial thinking. We are modeling We can get children to model maps as well using 3D materials, but we're also modelling as teachers and then we're mapping for them. So the child's own mapping and teacher mapping as well, working together. We can take this even further. We can think about something called body draping, which is where we think about our bodies in relationship to features in the school grounds. And so that we want children to be very safe, we can use teddies instead of bodies. So rather than them trying to climb up a tree or something or get onto a branch or squeeze into a narrow gap, we can use teddies and toys to do this for us. And children love doing these kinds of activities. Where are we going to put Ted? How can we describe where Ted is? Let's take a photograph. Let's use that really important geographical and positional language that helps with our maths as well. So where shall we put Ted? On the rock? Under the tree? Beneath the arch? Beside the bench? Etc. You get the idea. But all the time, we are reinforcing this vocabulary and this spatial thinking through embodied references and through our vocabulary. We can take photographs, we can draw it, we can sketch it, we can make models, and we can add to maps. We can also use small figures in landscapes to start posing questions and develop inquiry in the early years. And this inquiry can lead to further mapping, asking what kind of a place is this? Or thinking about that emotive aspect, how does he feel to be there and why? Is he upset that he's on a cut down piece of tree? What's this pipe doing here? What comes through here? What's it for? Where are these features? What is the best place for a gnome? And the last one, the gnome reference, is particularly important because we have some wonderful resources on the link there from Primary Geography, again, from Sharon Witt and Helen Clark, who have written a lot about gnome wisdom that is really excellent for use in the early years. So using small play figures, apart from being fun, apart from giving us a real context for developing mapping and modelling, modelling by the teacher and modelling in 3D by the child, what else does it do? It helps with a sense of scale. We help children to zoom in and talk about and notice that minutiae of detail. We're developing that directional locational language. We're using naming vocabulary to name and recognise features. We're using descriptive vocabulary. We're being emotive and effective as well, thinking about those feelings. We're also using that vital mathematical language, comparative language, bigger, smaller, busier, noisier, etc. But we're also raising an awareness of issues. Whose place is this? Who looks after it? How might it be changed for the better? So there's an awful lot just in that small world play, and where we might position that small world and then get children to create their own scenes and maps. So moving up to the progression in mapping for reception, age 4 to 5. And again, a lot more development has taken place by this reception age group. So children are now able to derive information from a simple map. They're able to much more confidently use plan views to find and mark features. They can follow a simple map using landmarks. They can point to north and south poles on the globe. We can use a compass to identify the direction of north in the playground, and children will start to remember that it's always in the same place. We can start to create maps from memory as well. And we can use simple symbols on maps to show features and journeys. And as far as digital maps go, children are able in reception to manipulate and annotate large-scale maps. They can use Digimaps, for example, zooming into a topographical scale of the school grounds. And with support, they can add simple text, markers, and photographs very easily. So here we've got Lola, age 5, who draws her map from memory of a simple walk. And I've put this quote here from work from the Meaningful Map team, of which I'm a member, and you can see some of the work and the maps that we've collected on the meaningfulmaps.org website. And Vojakovic et al. Say that children are remarkably adept at making maps. and they appear to develop the spatial awareness required to do this from an early age. They are very confident mappers. And these maps that young children draw not only provide a fascinating insight into their practical engagement, but they also tell us about places that interest, that they value, or that worry them. So there's a lot that we can find out about children from the maps they draw as well from memory. And if we look at this map that this five-year-old has drawn, we can see we've not just got features here, but we've got a steep, dangerous, windy hill. We've got an old pool, a tree blowing over, so things that perhaps are potentially worrying, as well as things that just happen to be there. And if we compare that with a map of the same journey from a 10-year-old, we can see the difference in how the 10-year-old has moved on, in which this map's got a key, it's got a plan view as well as some drawings and a lot more detail and specialised vocabulary. So we just need to remind ourselves that when children draw these maps of their walks and everyday activities, that a young child will see a place in terms of activity, what they can do there. It's what Gibson calls the affordance of place. And Ross notes that this imaginary plane, emotional engagement with their environment, happens when children have some degree of autonomy. So it's really important to let them explore and think about their own directions in a space where we can. What do they want to do there? What do they think the place is good for? But sadly, we know that children today don't have an awful lot of opportunity for free play outside. And Roger Hart did a seminal study many years ago about children in place and found that their outdoor experiences were rich and varied. But sadly, repeating the activity quite recently, well, a few years ago, we found that there was obviously a lot less time for free play now, and children didn't seem to know their environment as well as they perhaps did in the past. So thinking about the amount of access that children have got outside of school and talking to them about places they know really tells us a lot about what they can do as well. The power of natural and found objects and maps, the two go together really well. And here we see children at a playgroup. These images are courtesy of Clock Hill Playgroup in Bedfordshire. And the children have collected stones. They've had lots of fun painting them, decorating them with their own symbols. And these children are absolutely intrigued by ordnance survey maps. Now, this is quite a technical ordnance survey map, not one we'd normally think of presenting to early years children, but they're having lots of fun just looking at the maps, talking about the colours, the patterns, and placing their stones on them and telling stories. So never underestimate the fun that can be had just with an ordinary paper ordnance survey map and lots of stones to paint and use the imagination with. But that goes for all kinds of natural objects. So encourage children to make maps out of doors using found objects and encourage the secret world of their own to really flourish and come into being. Children's imaginations are an incredibly powerful thing. Perhaps moving on to more formal maps, we might think, well, how can we use the school grounds? Well, we can measure them in different ways. We can talk about the number of steps. We can count how long it takes us to get from A to B. This is moving on with older children and reception. We can look at a grid square within the school grounds, a meter grid square, and just look at exactly what's in that meter square. We can use magnifying glasses and map that square and think about how many daisies we can spot, how many spiders we can spot. We can talk about the school grounds and think about where is the best place for a picnic, game of football, a story, a shady sit down, perhaps for meeting friends. So thinking about the different aspects of place and getting children to be the experts in judging which places are best is another really good activity that we can do and then map the results. Or this is another activity that I've done myself with reception children, in which you have a letter mysteriously brought to reception to say that someone has left some animals that badly need reception's help in the school grounds, and here is the location where the animals are hidden. Please can we help find them and look after them? So we all go outside and hunt for them using the maps find them, and of course look after them very carefully. Or perhaps you're organising a teddy bear's picnic in the school ground. How can we do this? What space do we need? Where is the best place to sit if it's hot? Do we need shade? Where's the grounds best to sit? Where's the most even place to sit, for example? So lots of activities that we can make relevant for the children using the school grounds once we get into reception and further on. So I'm now going to talk a little bit about the role of globes, maps and atlases together. And what we're doing here, we're preparing children for more formal mapping later on. We're giving them the tools and the language and encouraging this curiosity and play all the time. So we can have lots of fun with Blark globes. If we have Blark globes, we can play by throwing them and having games such as, can you find me the North Pole, the South Pole? Can you find me that imaginary line around the middle called the equator? Can you find where we live? So we start to build up children's locational knowledge about the world. Globes are especially important in the early years because, of course, they're 3D. They're a better model of what actually is than 2D maps, although we want to have a range of 2D maps as well, all kinds of maps. But it's quite hard for children to understand that transition from 3 to 2D maps. So we can help explain that, perhaps using oranges, by peeling an orange and talking about how difficult it is to make the peel on an orange lie flat, and explaining that maps have to, obviously they have to make a compromise, and they can't show it as accurately as a globe does when we think about the shape of the world. But we can also use oranges, and they're quite a useful tool to get children to draw on with felt pens. We can, for example, imagine that it's a world, and can we draw and mark the poles? Can we find the North Pole and the South Pole? If that's the North Pole, then that must be the South Pole, because of course we can talk about which way up is it in space, and there is no right way in space. But once you've got one pole, you can get the other, and we can get that idea of relativity. We can also get children to mark that imaginary line, the equator, around the middle. And from those beginnings, by giving children this geometrical framework of how the world works, we can then start to build this locational knowledge. Because we can then look at a globe and say, let's look at this huge continent called Africa. And we can see that we've got some above the equator and some below the equator. And actually, it looks a bit like an elephant's ear. So later on, when children are ready, we can start to draw that shape in relation to the equator and the poles and get an understanding of where places are. So those are the early beginnings of how we can start to develop the more locational aspects of geography. And Wiegand tells us that children go along this kind of journey when they start to draw maps of the world. And it moves from stage one, which is the isolated units, to units of different size, and then we get more differentiated shapes, we get some increasing accuracy, and then eventually a formal map. And obviously this is a very drawn out process that happens from the early years and into primary. But if we can start to model and support children by developing a geometrical framework as well, then by modeling this, we can help children hang their locational knowledge onto something that's a little bit more easy to comprehend. And there's this very nice quote from Wiegand from 2006 as well. So we've got using maps, we've got making maps, and they've both got different kind of aspects to them. So using maps is about exploring the familiar and the unfamiliar world through models and through representation. We want children to be navigating paths and routes, and all the time they're developing this understanding of pattern. So we can have pretend paths and routes inside the classroom, but preferably outside the classroom in the playground. You might have footsteps marked in permanent colour, for example, across the playground. We can use chalk to get children to create their own paths and routes. It's about unlocking information and developing this visual literacy as well, and being inspired by the possibilities. Maps are imaginative tools. And we get children to develop their skills of orientation, thinking about which direction they're facing. They could be playing with compasses. So when they're drawing their routes. They could be talking about, I'm heading north. And even very young children pick this up very easily. And then in making maps as well, we want children to be translating their perceptions of the world, thinking about how they feel about it, and developing this ability all the time to translate their firsthand and concrete experiences into this abstract expression. So through this combination of exploratory play and teacher modelling, through this partnership of talk and using gesture and embodied thinking, we can help children to express their feelings and knowledge about place. Now, Geest says that map-making walks are a really valuable tool. And he says this, the importance of children's exploration of their environment goes beyond the obvious benefits of physical activity and exposure to nature, because every time they walk, they are constructing this mental coordinate system. Each time they make a turn or they notice a landmark, they are building their mapping ability. Each time they explain how to get from A to B, they're constructing this two-dimensional coordinate system. So map-making walks is a very simple but a very powerful tool in developing children's ability. And I've just adapted some of the commentary by Geest, and it's a really good read if you get a chance to have a look, and the references are all at the end as well, and they're all in the Ordnance Survey document as well. So I've just pulled out eight things that I think are really important. First of all, frequent familiarity with a range of maps. So get those different maps in, different scales, different kinds of maps, different sources, story maps, real maps, imaginary maps, tourist maps. Have them available and get children to talk about them and use them as much as possible. Have frequent walks. And doing the same walk over and over again can be a really valuable activity, that depth that's so important, because you notice places at different times of the day, in different seasons, and how they change. And children develop this confidence and this familiarity. And then getting children to do models of part of their walk, taking photographs as well, and creating their own maps and their play maps in the playground as well from their walk is really valuable. Take time to stop and talk about and notice as you go on a walk. So just stop and tune in. Get children to look up, look down. Note the kind of vocabulary that they're using and model it back to them. And really develop children's ability to ask questions, which will come over time. And again, that's something that we can do by modelling to them. Really encourage children to use all their senses, but also give children time to explore. We want those sensory motory skills to matter to young children. And of course, we've got the different kinds of sensory motor skills. We've got the gross motor skills and the more particular skills that we need to actually draw maps. And if we get children to use their senses, we help them to remember what they've seen and the touch of things, like touching tree bark, for example. And if we do journey strings as well as take those back, then that helps even more. Use that positional language when we notice landmarks next to, beside. And use relational language to help children describe where. Group maps are really good because children have to discuss and agree where to put things. And I think most of all, the bit I've highlighted at the end is just provide those opportunities for them to develop these maps. So what does this look like in practice? Here are some maps from a reception class in school from children aged 4 and 5. And I asked the children, I asked them to work in groups, and I said, can you make me a map of your school to show me what's outside the door when we leave your classroom and go out into the school ground? Can you make a map from memory? Now, this might sound like quite a tall ask for 4 and 5-year-olds, but not at all. They were able to rise to the challenge and create these wonderfully detailed maps using found objects, these messy maps. And they had support and prompts, but when they talked back afterwards and explained what their map showed, they had lots of detailed vocabulary, and the spatial accuracy was quite amazing, because I went outside afterwards and checked the detail of trees, of the playground. They added on other features such as benches, lots of detail. And here we've got the children beginning to explain. This is one group explaining the woods at the bottom, the benches and the playground where they played, and the very large oak tree that was a significant feature. And then in the same school, I moved on to year one class, and working with talking partners, these children were able to talk about features and draw their map from memory. And then we went outside afterwards to check. So we can see the leap there that's come on from children using these found 3D objects, more of a modelling and maps, to this more abstract map making that children are capable of just a year later. This is a year one class here, and here we're introducing Digimaps, and children were able to use the aerial image of Digimaps and identify features. They recognise their school, they recognise the car park and the church. And what we did then, after children had recognised some of these features, we used a printed out map and we took children into the playground. We had them in groups of about 5 and 6 in a group, and we had lots of chunky chalks, and we drew large boxes, large rectangles on the playground. And we had compasses as well, and the children were familiar with finding north. So we made sure we orientated ourselves again, finding north with the map. And then we found the school, and we asked children to jump into the rectangle where they thought the school was. So once the children had jumped in and collaboratively agreed where the school was on their rectangle with relation to their map, we then said, right, draw your map. Can you copy this map and put in all the things that are important? And here was the children engaged in this activity. And the maps were incredibly detailed. They were just absolutely brilliant. And what was very interesting is that they didn't just use the map as a reference point, but they added in their own personal meanings. Everybody added the chip shop in their map. So every group had the chip shop for that place. So really encourage children to bring out their own personal meanings of space as well. And this is a nice, simple activity that can be adapted and just encourage with even younger children to do chunky chalks and maps on the playground. And you can either even scaffold this for younger children by putting in some predestined sort of buildings and things like that, and getting children to add to the map and augment it. Or perhaps that familiar activity that you do when you have a large sheet of paper on the tabletop and you start off a map for toy cars and vehicles, and you say to children, here's some pens, can you develop this map? Can you add some buildings and some play figures to it? So maps and stories as well. I'm going to talk a little bit about maps and stories because these are very much interlinked. And Vegan back in 2006 alerted us to what is now quite a popular aspect of cognitive theory, the dual coding theory, in which map and verbal knowledge are thought to have different representations in long-term memory storage. So using maps alongside vocabulary and talking and writing helps children to remember things. So which is quite handy because maps are not just fun, but they're really functional and useful too. So we can use story and maps together very effectively. I've just used a very well-known story here, Little Red Riding Hood. There are some other examples in the document. So we can see how there are opportunities right the way across these different areas of learning. So with our communication and language, for example, we're developing our vocabulary. We might be acting out the story with props in the play corner. In physical development, we've got the gross motor skills, in that we can actually create a route in the playground from home to granny's house and run along it, or we can walk along it very slowly, or we can creep along it, we can use different movements. We've got our fine motor skills in actually creating smaller maps and plans and notes to Nanny to warn her. So in our personal, social and emotional development, for example, we can talk about the different emotions during the story and so on. So you can see that maps help us as a very powerful tool to unravel all these different areas of learning and combine them all together. And I've put some links there because on the Digimap website, we've got links to some resources. There is a resource for using Digimaps to talk about where I live. And there's also an activity, how to get to grandma safely, that's suitable for reception children. So here we've got a map drawn using the fine motor skills we just talked about of Little Red Riding Hood's journey. And we've got a teacher comment here. We talked about the story and how we could make a map to show Little Red Riding Hood's journey. They told me the features they remembered and I wrote these down. So trying to develop the idea of a key as well, which is very ambitious. But again, with collaborative learning and modelling, it makes it achievable. We discussed how we could use different colours to show Grandma's house and Little Red Riding Hood house. This didn't happen. We can see on the map that they're both the same colour. But we had an exciting retell using the map as a prompt. So having made the map, that is now a tool, a very powerful tool for that child to remember that story and do a retell. So I'm going to finish this session by just reminding us about maps, geography, and identity. And Christopher Spencer gave us this really important quote when we think about doing geography, that we're doing more than just participating in geography. We are helping children develop their self-identity, their sense of worth, their values, and their sense of belonging as well. So maps help children talk about all of this and develop it. So what about provision? Well, the sky's your limit, really, but inflatable globes, different sizes, standalone globes for story time, OS maps at a large scale of the local area, and access to digital mapping with annotation facilities such as Digimap schools, because children pick this up really quickly, and it's so good for fine motor skills as well for them to trace over maps, add lines, add annotation. Some first atlases, some story maps, aerial imagery, again, very important. We want children to start with aerial imagery and recognising features. And a range of media and prompts for creating these 3D and 2D maps, sand, water, natural and found objects, small world play. And you might have some large-scale printed maps cut up into rectangles, laminated to make simple jigsaws and talking points. How does it all fit together? And that's the end for me. So I'm going to stop the share now and we'll open the questions.
Paula, there's a question there. Is there a link or an article for the journey strings? It sounds like a fabulous idea.
Where is that? Oh, yeah, there is. If you Google Journey Strings by Jane Whittle, there should be a video clip somewhere of this in action. But if you go on the Geographical Association website there and Google Journey Strings, you should find some material there. I meant to say as well that on the Royal Geographical Society website, there's a whole free unit on stay home mapping with lots of mapping ideas as well for early years and Key Stage 1 and Key Stage 2.
Right. There's also a question from Gina. Can you recommend any EYFS friendly atlases?
I can't think off the top of my head, but I know there is one I've got in my head. I'm trying to think of it now. I wonder if Sharon Witt or Helen Martin can come in on this and if they've got any ideas, because I can't think. Colin's first atlas is good, says Lauren. That's useful. I think it might have been Colin's. Colin's normally is a good name to go to, because they have Stephen Scoffram as an advisor. He's always good value, very knowledgeable. The website just meant, oh, someone's put that down. Yes, the Geographical Association and the Royal Geographical Society, both good websites to look at for geography. And Phillips, that was the one I was thinking of, the Phillips Infant School Atlas. It was that one. Yes. They're both good, Phillips and Collins. But do get your Blark globes. They're fantastic, really essential.